Shalom, everyone, and welcome to another Bits of Torah Truths. We are in the Simchat Torah series, the Joy of Torah series, and this week's Torah portion is Parashat Vayekhel. And I titled the study this week, The Bronze Laver and Mirrors. Okay, so this week's reading is from Parashat Vayekhel, and Moshe, and it's from Exodus 35, verse 1 to 38, verse 20, and Moshe assembled the entire congregation of Israel and said, "These are the things the Lord has commanded you to do. They are to keep the seventh day as holy to the Lord. No work is to be done on the Shabbat. A terumah, a contribution, is to be made to the Lord, like it was described in Parashat Terumah. Gold, silver, bronze, blue, purple, and scarlet material, goat's hair, ram skin, porpoise skins, acacia wood, olive oil, incense, and onyx stones for the setting of the ephod and the breastplate." Moshe describes the construction of the tabernacle. Moshe called Bezalel and Hoholiab to begin the work of building the sanctuary. The scriptures detail the construction of the curtains, the walls of the tabernacle, and the Ark of the Covenant. The utensils used for the daily sacrifice were constructed. The menorah was constructed, and the altar of incense was constructed from acacia wood and overlaid with pure gold. The altar for the burnt offering was constructed next. It was overlaid with bronze, and the laver was then constructed. And then the remainder of the parsha details the construction of the court of the tabernacle, and Moshe gives an accounting of the materials used in the construction of the tabernacle, constructed by Bezalel and Oholiab. And in following the construction of the Mishkan, Moshe assembles everything, anoints him with oil, and commissions Aaron and his sons into the priestly service. Now, when studying this week's Torah portion, it's interesting what the scriptures say concerning the construction of the bronze laver. And for some reason, I'd never noticed this before. I thought this was a really interesting topic to discuss. But Moshe writes in Exodus 38, verse 8, he says, "Moreover, he made the laver of bronze with its base of bronze from the mirrors of the serving women who served at the doorway of the tent of meeting." Okay, so the bronze laver was made from the mirrors of the serving women. And when I read that, I thought, what does that mean? And when the priests washed their hands, would they see themselves? You know, I mean, when they used the mirrors, did they keep their luster? You know, did they polish them? And were the mirrors made of bronze, which was then transformed into the laver? And apparently, the statement regarding the mirrors being used for the construction of the laver has a very significant meaning, which we can discuss here in this week's Torah portion. Now, the scriptures we're looking at specifically are Exodus chapter 38, verses 1 through 8 on page 2 there. And it says in the study, it says, "Then he made the altar of burnt offering of acacia wood, 5 cubits long and 5 cubits wide, square and 3 cubits high. He made its horns on its four corners, its horns being of one piece with it, and he overlaid it with bronze. He made all the utensils of the altar, the pails and the shovels and the basins, the flesh hooks and the fire pans. He made all its utensils of bronze. He made for the altar a grating of bronze network beneath, under its ledge, reaching halfway up. He cast four rings on the four ends of the bronze grating as holders for the poles. He made the poles of acacia wood and overlaid them with bronze. He inserted the poles into the rings of the side of the altar with which to carry it. He made it hollow with planks. Moreover, he made the laver of bronze with its base of bronze from the mirrors of the serving women who served at the doorway of the tent of meeting." Okay, so that was Exodus 38, verses 1 through 8. And so Moshe, he writes in the Torah, he says that, "Moreover, he made the laver of bronze with his base of bronze from the mirrors of the serving women who served at the doorway of the tent of meeting." And according to the scriptures, the bronze laver or wash basin was made from the mirrors of the serving women. And a mirror is a flat or a curved surface usually produced of glass that has had a reflective coating applied to it. The reflection was most likely discovered by looking into pools of water, streams, and rivers, which acted as the first mirrors. In ancient times, the earliest man-made mirrors were from polished stone or metal. And in this case, it is very likely that the mirrors of the women were, who served at the entrance of the tent of meeting, had mirrors made of polished bronze. These bronze mirrors were then transformed into the laver. And an interesting concept here is the result of the mirrors being transformed into the laver. When the priests washed their hands, they would see themselves and be reminded that they were imperfect people serving a perfect God. Now, the rabbis have some to say concerning these scripture verses and concerning the mirrors and the serving women in the bronze laver. And so let's look at that. Da Zekanim on Exodus 38, verse 8, part 1, it says, with the mirrors of the serving women, women chastely performing their tasks near the entrance of the tabernacle, Moses wished that the women could observe how their mirrors donated for the construction of the tabernacle had been used as a polished cover for the altar situated in front of the entrance to the tabernacle. This was next to the wash basin for the priest from which they washed their hands and feet, and from the waters contained therein. That a woman suspected of infidelity, sota, would be made to drink in order to prove that she was innocent of that sin. Okay, so Da Zekanim provides a rabbinic interpretation that the mirrors were used to construct a polished cover for the altar. And it's interesting how the mirrors were donated for the wash basin used for washing the hands and feet, and is also the waters from which one drinks in order for a wife to prove she was innocent of the sin of unfaithfulness. And this draws in the concept of the wash basin being polished. And when one washed the hands and feet, one saw himself in reflection, not only from the water, but also from the polished bronze. The point is, the priest was conscious of his sins before God, since the washing was performed prior to entering the tabernacle. In a similar manner, both the husband and wife would be conscious of their sins when going before the Lord for the waters of the sota. Now, Sforno, he has the following to say on page 4. Sforno says, this was not included in the copper for the waving, as explained in verse 30 of this chapter in Parashat Pekudi. The copper basin and its stand are mentioned as having been constructed from the amount of copper representing these mirrors. Approaching this holy domain was intended to show that they wanted to hear the words of the living God. That this was an acceptable practice is already documented in chapter 33, verse 7. Anyone who wanted to seek out the Lord would go out to the tent of meeting. The women who had donated these mirrors indicated that they had overcome their sense of vanity. They considered jewelry and the need for it a human weakness. Moreover, they knew that the time when these mirrors had been of constructive use was past. Okay, so according to Sforno, now Sforno doesn't really have too much to add. The copper basin was created with a representative amount of the mirrors, and the mentioning of the women who had donated the mirrors indicated their overcoming the sense of vanity, where jewelry and mirrors are considered a human weakness due to the sin of vanity. Now Rashi, he says the following. He says that for the mirrors of the women who had set up the legions, the Israelite women owned mirrors which they would look into when they adorned themselves. Even these mirrors they did not look back from bringing as a contribution toward the Mishkan, but Moshe rejected them because they were made for temptation. For example, to inspire lustful thoughts. The Holy One, blessed be He, said to him, accept them, for these are more precious to me than anything, because through them the women set up many legions. For example, through the children they give birth to in Egypt. When their husbands were weary from back-breaking labor, they, the women, would go and bring food and drink and give them to eat. Then they, the women, would take the mirrors, and each one would see herself with her husband in the mirror, and she would seduce him with words, saying, I am more beautiful than you. And in this way they aroused their husband's desire and would copulate with them, conceiving and giving birth there, as it is said, under the apple tree I aroused you. This is the meaning of what is written, that the mirrors of those who set up legions, from those the mirrors, the wash stands was made, because its purpose was to make peace between a man and his wife. How so? How so? By giving a drink from the water that was in it, the washstand, to a woman whose husband had warned her not to stay in private with a certain man, and she concluded herself with him anyway, the water would test her and either destroy or prove her innocence. You should know that they were actually mirrors, because it is said, the copper of the waving was 70 talents. From that he made. But the washstand and its basin were not mentioned there. Among the things produced from the 70 talents, thus you have learned that the copper of the washstand was out of the copper of the waving. So did Rabbi Tanhuma expounded on the matter, and so did Onkelos render the mirrors of the woman, which is the Aramaic translation of Marot, mirrors in French. So we find in Isaiah 3:23, which we render as and the mirrors. Okay, so according to Rashi, Moshe rejected the mirrors for the construction of the tabernacle because it was related to temptation in the sense of lustful thoughts. The Lord, however, told Moshe to accept them because it was through them the women bore many children. And this draws in the idea of the Yetzer Hara and the Yetzer HaTov, both of which the Lord God had created and given to man. Lustful thoughts were related to the Yetzer Hara, where without the Yetzer Hara, man would not build a house, take a wife, or have children, as we read here according to Rashi and elsewhere in the rabbinic literature. And according to Rashi, the mirror was used by the women to seduce the man, and so was used as a way to make peace between a husband and wife. All of these things tie together the concepts of the husband, the wife, the sota, the mirrors, and the wash basin, and sin. Okay. Now, Shnei Lukhot Habrit has the following to say, and you see on page 6 and 7, it says that our sages added that the animal first has to be thrown into the ground forcefully as a symbol of man having thrown down his own person, thereby confessing that he himself is guilty of death by stoning. When the animal is slaughtered, that is equivalent to the owner killing himself, suggesting that he is guilty of the two death penalties, death by the sword and death by hanging. There is a momentary feeling of choking experienced by the animal before the knife slices through its throat. Then, when the animal is burned on the altar, this symbolizes the fourth kind of death penalty, death by burning. The owner of the animal recites a confession and God accepts it. The priest must also see to it that at the time when he sprinkles the animal's blood on the altar, the man or woman for whom he performs the service should observe what he is doing. The priest is not himself allowed to look directly at a woman while he performs service in the precincts of the temple. A copper laver used in the temple was made of the mirrors the Jewish women used in Egypt when they prettied themselves for their husbands. When the priest offers a sin offering by a woman, he looks at this copper laver and sees her reflection in it. And this has been explained by Recanati. The rule we learn from all that we have described above is that the person who offers a sacrifice should regard himself as being sacrificed. He is then fulfilling when a person sacrifices himself as a gift offering. Okay, so notice how Shnei Lukhot Habrit Vayikra, Torah or 37, relates all of these things together. The animal for the sacrifice, death for stoning and by sword, the animal being burned upon the altar, lustful thoughts during the priestly service, the copper laver, the mirrors of the women who served at the entrance to the tent of meeting, etc. All these things come together and may be interpreted as the rule we learn from all that we have described above is that the person who offers a sacrifice should regard himself as being sacrificed. He is then fulfilling when a person sacrificed himself as a gift offering. The concept may be related here to what the Apostle Paul wrote in Romans 12, verses 1 and 2. It says, therefore, I urge you, brethren, by the mercies of God, to present your bodies a living and holy sacrifice acceptable to God, which is your spiritual service of worship. And do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, so that you may prove that what the will of God is, that which is good and acceptable and perfect. These concepts of the laver, the mirrors, animal sacrifice, and the sota draw in the realization of our shortcomings and a need for the mercy and the grace of God and His forgiveness. In this week's Torah portion, it is important to note that the items given for the construction of the tabernacle were a terumah, a voluntary contribution. The Torah says, from every person whose heart moves him, in relation to the laver being made from the mirrors of the women who served at the entrance to the tent of meeting. These women gave of themselves, they gave up their vanity for the service of the Lord. And according to the rabbis, the laver assumed the characteristic or the character of those mirrors in the sense that the laver brought out something about the person who was involved in the service of the Lord. The priest would wash, bringing to memory the nature of his sins before God, similar to the case of the sota, where husband and wife would come before the Lord. The mirror of the laver reminded them of their sins in the covenant relationship, the marriage, were made known before God. According to the sages, it is no coincidence that the sota was made to drink from the water of this laver, which was made from the mirrors of the women who were dedicated to holiness. It is fitting, therefore, that it was used to reveal the truth in case of a woman who deviated from holiness in her covenant relationship with her husband. This stood as a constant reminder for the priest of his sins and unfaithfulness that he may have been committed in his covenant relationship with the Lord in heaven. If we consider the context of these things, the laver also represents washing away the ego, selfishness, and negative feelings towards others. Before the priest entered the tabernacle, he would ceremoniously wash his hands and feet at a special bronze laver, symbolically ridding himself of sin before approaching the Lord God. Considering mirrors were used in the construction of the laver, the bronze laver may have been a giant mirror. What was the function of a mirror-like laver? When the priest would wash, peering into the mirror, he would see not only himself, but everything behind him. And note that the laver would have reflected the sky above as an illustration of the throne of God in the heavens. And as a result, the priest would have brought to mind this origin, the Creator, and the purpose for which his soul was sent to earth. His purpose in life is to serve the Lord. He would have been reminded of his sins, which would lead to his repentance and confession before God just prior to entering the tabernacle. So the essential part from this week's Torah portion, based upon these scriptures, is the function of the laver represents our lives in the Messiah Yeshua. We come to the realization that we are not perfect and need a Savior. The Apostle John wrote in 1 John chapter 1, verse 7, "But if we walk in the light as he himself is in the light, we have fellowship with one another, and the blood of Jesus Christ, his Son, cleanses us from all sin." The context of walking in the light is to that of living in righteousness before God. Yeshua cleansing us in his blood, and our walking in righteousness or being washed by the word are all concepts that have been drawn out by the rabbis in their commentaries on the laver. These things are connected to having an intimate union between a man and his wife in a covenant relationship, which parallels our relationship with the Father in heaven in Yeshua the Messiah. The sota represents our guilt before God and sin. Yeshua said in John chapter 7, verse 37, "If any man thirst, let him come to me and drink." It was on the great day of the Feast of Tabernacles when the Jewish leaders were pouring the water from the pool of Siloam. And this is a reference to the words of the prophet Ezekiel in Ezekiel 36, verse 25 to 34, which says, "Then I will sprinkle clean water on you, and you will be clean. I will cleanse you from all your filthiness and from all your idols. Moreover, I will give you a new heart and put a new spirit within you. And I will remove the heart of stone from your flesh and give you a heart of flesh. I will put my spirit within you and cause you to walk in my statutes, and you will be careful to observe my ordinances. You will live in the land that I give to your forefathers, so that you will be my people and I will be your God. Moreover, I will save you from all your uncleanness, and I will call for the grain and multiply it. I will not bring a famine on you. I will multiply the fruit of the tree and the produce of the field, so you will not receive grain again the disgrace of famine among the nations. Then you will remember your evil ways and your deeds that were not good, and you will loathe yourselves in your own sight for your iniquities and your abominations. I am not doing this for your sake, declares the Lord God. Let it be known to you. Be ashamed and confounded for your ways, O house of Israel. Thus says the Lord God, on the day that I cleanse you from all of your iniquities, I will cause the cities to be inhabited, and the waste place will be rebuilt. The desolate land will be cultivated instead of being desolate in the sight of everyone who passes by. Okay, so that was Ezekiel 36, verse 25 and 34. And so the laver draws in the context of all of these things, recognizing we need cleansed from our sins, repentance, and receiving the forgiveness of God in heaven and of the Messiah Yeshua, through whom all these things are possible. Okay, so that concludes the Torah story study. Does anyone have any comments? I'll release the mic here.